In philosophy, there's this concept of universals. So Plato had the forms,
yeah,
and then would say that this is almost rectangular, so it's embodying the rectangularness, which is somehow somewhere out there, akin to what I imagine you meant when you said intelligence is there being embodied by this. But then there's Aristotle, which says, okay, yes, there is something akin to a form, it's just not out there. It's actually in here. The rectangularness is a property of this microphone. So I imagine this latter view is the one that most biologists would take. Not that there's intelligence out there, let's just grab it and instantiate it here. No, something has the property of intelligence. So explain what you mean when you say embodying intelligence, yeah, and also what you mean by intelligence.
Yeah. Let's see. And just a quick thing to finish real quick, the previous thought, which is that the reason I think this stuff is not these are not questions of philosophy. These are very practical questions of science because they lead to specific actionable technology. So the idea that what's going on in cancer is a shrinking of the cognitive light cone leads directly to a research program where you say, well, instead of killing these cells with chemotoxic chemotherapies, because I believe that they're, you know, genetically irrevocably damaged, maybe what we can do is force them into better electrical networks with their neighbors, and that's exactly what we've done. And so we've had lots of success expressing strong human oncogenes in frog embryo cells, and then leaving the oncoproteins be, but instead making sure that they're connected into tight electrical networks with their neighbors, and they normalize. They make nice skin, nice muscle. They do their normal thing instead of being metastatic, and so. And so that kind of thing, you know, it's very important to me that all these ideas, and so we'll talk about in a minute about Platonic space and things like that. It's important to me that all of these ideas don't just remain as kind of philosophical musings, but they have to make contact with the real world, and specifically, not just explaining stuff that was done before, but facilitating new advances. They have to enable new research programs that weren't possible before. That's what I think is the value of all of this kind of these deep philosophical discussions. So let's see, with respect to the definition of intelligence. So I like, for practical purposes, I like William James's definition, which is the some degree of the ability to reach the same goal by different means. And that presupposes, it's an interesting definition because it presupposes that there is some problem space that the agent is working on, but it does not say you have to be a brain. It doesn't say you have to be natural versus artificial. It doesn't say any of that. It's a very cybernetic definition. What it says is that you have some amount of skill in navigating that problem space to get to where you want to go, despite interventions, despite surprise, despite various barriers in your way. How much competency do you have to achieve that? And that was his definition of intelligence. Now, I will certainly agree that that doesn't capture everything that we care about in cognition. So a focus on problem solving doesn't handle play, and it doesn't handle emotions and things like that. But for the purposes of our work, I focus on the problem solving aspects of intelligence. So within that, your point about the Platonic space. So now to be clear, everything that I was saying before, I think we have very strong empirical evidence for. And so now I'm going to, in answering this question, I'm just going to talk about stuff that I'm not sure of yet, and that these are ideas we don't, you know, I don't feel strongly that we've shown that any of this is true. But this is my opinion, and this is where our research is going now. I actually think that the Platonic view is more correct, and I know this is not how most biologists think about things. I think that in the exact same way that mathematicians that are sympathetic to the Platonic worldview, this idea that there are, in fact, in some way, there is a separate world in which various rules of number theory and various facts of mathematics and various properties of computation and things like that, right? That there's a separate space where these things live. And importantly, the idea is that, you know, they think that we discover those things. We don't invent them or create them. We discover them, that and that they would be true still if all the facts of the physical universe were different. They would still, you know, they would still be true, right? I extend that idea in a couple of ways. One is, I think that what exists in that Platonic space is not just rules of mathematics and things like that, which are in a certain sense low agency kind of objects because they just sort of sit there doing, you know, they don't do much. I actually think that there's a spectrum of that. And some of the components of that Platonic space have much higher agency. I think it's a space of minds as well, and of different ways to be intelligent. And I think that just like when you make certain devices, you suddenly harness the rules of computation, rules of mathematics that are basically free lunches. You know, there are so many things you can build that will suddenly have properties that you didn't have to bake in. You know, you get that for free, basically, right? I think intelligence is like that. I think some of the components of that Platonic space are actually minds. And sometimes what happens when you build a particular kind of body, whether it's one that's familiar to us with a brain and so on, or really some very unfamiliar architectures, whether they be alien or synthetic or whatever, I think what you're doing is you're harnessing a pre-existing intelligence that is there in the same way that you harness various laws of mathematics and computation when you build specific devices.
Okay, well, that's super interesting. So at any moment, there's Michael Levin, but there's Michael Levin at 11 a.m., then there's Michael Levin at 11:01 a.m., and it's not clear they're the same. So there's the river, do you step in it? This is the same river. Okay, cool. There's a through line. There's something there, though. Maybe it's something like you're akin to what you were an epsilon amount of time previous, and then that's the through line. So as long as that's true, then you can draw a worm of you throughout time. Are you saying that at any slice of that, there was a Michael Levin in some Michael Levin space, which is also in the minds of human space, and you're picking out points somehow? You're traversing this space of minds.
That's actually even more specific than what I was saying. I mean, that's interesting, and I think that's what I was saying, that in general kinds of minds. So there are different. I don't know quite what to think about individual instances, but kinds of minds, you know.
Because that would be an extremely large space then.
Well, I think the space is extremely large, possibly infinite, but in fact, probably infinite. But I think what I was talking about was mainly types of different minds, types of cognitive systems. Now, for individuals, you raise a really interesting point, which is I call them selflets, which are the kind of the thin slices of experience that
you call them selflets.
Selflets.
Uh huh.
You know? Because you have a self, and then the different slices of it are the selflets, and you can look at it as, you know, kind of like that special relativity, you know, bread loaf, you know, sliced into pieces, that kind of thing. So I think what's interesting about asking that question about the self and what is the through line is what's really important there is to pick a vantage point of an observer. Again, kind of akin to what happens in relativity, you have to ask from whose perspective. So one of the things about being a continuous self is that other observers can count on your behaviors and your properties staying more or less constant. So the reason that we identify, oh yes, you know, you're the same person as you were before, is basically, you know, nobody cares that you have the same atoms or you don't, or the cells have been replaced. What you really care about is that this being, I can have the same kind of relationship with them that I had before. In other words, they're consistent. I can expect the same behaviors, the things that I think they know, they still know, and so on. And so that of course, in our human lives, that often breaks down because humans grow from being children to being adults. All their preferences change. The things that they remember and the things that they value change. In our own lives, we sometimes change, right? And that's a much more important change. You know, are you the same person, even though if all your material components remain the same, but you changed all your beliefs, all your preferences, would you still be the same person, right? So I think what we mean when we say the same is not about the matter of it at all. It's about what kind of relationship we can still have, and what do I expect from you behavior wise, and so on. And there's some really interesting, and so that's from the perspective of an external observer. Now, the latest work that I just published a couple of days ago looks at what does that mean from the perspective of the agent themselves, and this idea that You don't have access to your past. What you have access to are memory engrams, you know, traces of past experience that were deposited in your brain and possibly in your body that future you is going to have to interpret. And so that leads to a kind of a scenario where you treat your own memories as messages from your past self, you know. the idea then that is that those memories have to be interpreted. You don't necessarily know what they mean right away because you're different. You're not the same as you were, right? Especially over long periods of time. And this comes out very starkly in organisms that change radically, like caterpillars to butterfly. So memories persist from butterfly, from caterpillar to butterfly, but the actual detailed memories of the caterpillar are of absolutely no use to the butterfly. It doesn't eat the same stuff. It doesn't move in the same way. It has a completely different body, completely different brain. You can't just take the same memories. And so I think what happens in biology is that it is very comfortable. In fact, it depends on the idea that the substrate will change. You will mutate your cells. Some cells will die. New cells will be born. Material goes in and out. Unlike in our computational devices, the material is not, you're not committed to the fidelity of information the way that we are in our computation. You are committed to the salience of that information. So you will need to take those memory traces and reinterpret them for whatever your future situation is. In the case of the butterfly, completely different. In the case of the adult human, somewhat different than your brain when you were a child. But even during adulthood, your the context, your mental context, your environment, everything changes. And I think you don't really have an allegiance to what these memories meant in the past. You reinterpret them dynamically. And so this gives a kind of view of the self, kind of a process view of the self, that what we really are is a continuous dynamic attempt at storytelling, where what you're constantly doing is interpreting your own memories in a way that makes sense about what, you know, a coherent story about what you are, think what you believe about the outside world. And it's a constant process of self-construction. So that I think is what's going on with selves.
If it's the case then that we interpret our memories as messages from our past selves to our current selves, then can we reverse that and say that our current actions are messages to our future self?
Yeah. I think that's exactly right. I think that a lot of what we're doing now is at any given moment is behavior that is going to enable or constrain your future self. You know, you're setting the conditions in which the environment in which your future self is going to be living, including changing yourself. You know, anything you undertake as a self-improvement program, or conversely, you know, when people entertain intrusive or depressive thoughts, that changes your brain. That literally changes the way that your future self is going to be able to process information in the future. Everything you do radiates out not only as messages and a kind of niche construction, you know, where you're changing the environment in which you're going to live and which everybody else is going to live. We are constantly doing that to ourselves and to others. And so that, you know, really forces a kind of thinking about your future self as kind of akin to other people's future selves. And I think that also has important ethical implications, because once that symmetry becomes apparent, that your future self is not quite you, and also others' future selves are also not you, that suggests that the same reason you do things so that your future self will have a better life, you might want to apply that to others' future selves. Like breaking down this idea that, and I'm certainly not the first person to say this, but breaking down the idea that you are a persistent object, separate from everybody else, and you know, sort of persisting through time, breaking that down into a set of selves, and what you are doing now is basically for the good of a future self, I think makes you think differently about others' future selves at the same time.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.